Okay, good morning. Welcome back to you and me. Today is April 19, Wednesday. I'm in Thailand, in Chiang Mai, and the PM is decreasing, meaning particulate matter, and so the skies are a little more blue, a little, but it's super hot. It was like over 100 yesterday. But overall, it's quite nice. The owner here of this facility said, this is the worst it is in Thailand, April, the driest and hottest. If you're okay with it here now, you'll really love it when the rain comes and it gets greener and cooler and fresher. So that's nice. Okay, well, I want to present to you, though, something more relevant to you than my personal, the details of my personal process, which I don't think are that interesting, or doesn't, I don't think about endlessly. But the title for the talk that I'll talk today, about 40 minutes or so, is Levels of Knowing, and subtitle, Discovery Beyond Pride and Ignorance. It's clear to me that, number one, there's a difference between thinking some idea and a full comprehension to grok, G-R-O-K, from the book Stranger in a Strange Land. To grok it is not the same as to think it. Thinking some matter, which is a knowing at a kind of superficial intellectual level, superficial mental level, I think, it's knowing the theory, not the application. And there's a huge difference. I think I was reading this, I think, in it might have been Captain Hatengi or Chaitanyananda's intro preface to one of the translations of Nityananda, what became Chittakash Gita or the other Voice of the Self, talking about the difference between intellectually knowing and really living these teachings, Nityananda's teachings on that could be classed as Advaita Vedanta. There's a difference between thinking a truth and having so fully integrated it that there's no opposition, there's no doubt, and it's become second nature in a sense. It's become instinctual, it's returned to the roots of mind. And so levels of knowing pertain to what Ra calls the tree of mind. I was going to write an essay on that long ago. I think I started but didn't finish. I may have given some talks on tree of mind. The tree of mind theory is sort of, you know, pure epistemology from Ra, where, like a tree, you've got the visible and invisible. You've got the obvious and the hidden. And so, like outer, inner, secret, that's a Tibetan Buddhist perspective of three levels of truth in all teaching. There are levels of knowing. It's levels of truth or levels of knowing. The truth is sort of boundless, or truth is endless, in the sense that knowing one matter, one must know all associated matters. I look outside my room here. I see five small baby spruce trees, I think. They look like something like spruce or cedar, but they're only about, you know, 5 foot tall, 10 foot tall, something like that, between 5 and 8 feet or something. To know them fully, wouldn't I need to know the soil? To know the soil fully, wouldn't I need to know the geological history? know the geological history? Wouldn't I need to know the related geological tectonic history of this portion of the world and then associated regions? What's not associated? It's all interpenetrating, or it's all interrelated, all interconnected. And so to know any one, one must know the all, actually. And that's why in the end, omniscience, I presume, going from this octave to the next, relative omniscience, or omniscience of the octave, seven densities, 31 planes, it's a light switch that turns on. There's gradual, and then instantaneous, and then one, the beingness, or the spark of infinitude, dropping all illusions, knows, it becomes a know-it-all. The all is known by the one. That one, returning to the one, knows it all. Because you can't fully know any differential, you can't know the wave fully without knowing the ocean fully. And you can't know the ocean fully without knowing the planet and the solar system and the galaxy and the laws, dot, 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 dot. This is back to the perspective of the wisdom of ignorance. And so, you know, bringing it down to earth, to the personal, to the visceral, people have no idea how little they know. And the visible portion of the tree of mind, the canopy with the leaves and the branches and the trunk, is the conscious mind. The cat, one's character, moral character, is akin to the trunk, I'd say. And one's preferences and tendencies is akin to the branches. And one's particular individual or distinct thoughts and feelings are like the leaves. And the whole thing is in a worshipful stance or gesture to the solar, the sun in the sky. So the conscious mind as a sub-sub-sub-logos is the visible, akin to the visible portions of the tree of mind, like a tree that stands and pays homage or reverence to the sun in the sky, to which it is drawn. So the trees move to the sun as the conscious mind returns to Atman. But the only way to return to Atman, or sixth density, the true self with a capital S, you know, which is also ditched or thrown overboard, like Nisargadatta said when the Yani realizes his own death, or the being Ra in six drops identity, memory, goes to all, the all, seven, and off to eight. And so the conscious mind, like the visible portions of a tree, in the tree of mind analogy, has its backbone, which is moral, which is the choice of path, and how well developed the soul, the mind, is in its understanding of its own path. But then there's the invisible, the lower, the subterranean, which begins with the subconscious mind. And so there's the personal subconscious, there's the racial, meaning human race, not colored skin race, the racial mind, the planetary mind, which includes the racial but is of the earth, kind of Lucy going back in time to the beginning, and then the cosmic mind. That's a down and dirty overview of the tree of mind. The conscious mind knows very little of the whole of the tree of mind. The conscious mind knows very little of its own subconscious, as well as major currents and streams and tendencies of the collective so-called racial mind, as well as the planetary rhythms, planetary mind, as well as the cosmic. So we know very little. And most dopey human 3D repeaters think they know a lot. Now, there are a lot of people who don't think they know a lot. There's the educated and the uneducated. You know, I'm here in Thailand and I'm mixing up with the folks. I'm coming and going here and there and observing with the Volk. I'm with the Volk here. The Volk, the folk, the people. And I'm trying to understand, you know, what's happening here. There are the educated and the uneducated. Certainly here, there's a lot of people who are not, you know, they don't have a college degree or they don't have anything beyond. They maybe didn't finish high school. They may be quite moral, actually, or not, but they're not particularly thoroughly conditioned by the educational system, but they watch a lot of TV. Then they're heavily, these are generalizations. It's okay if 1 out of 20 doesn't like it. The 1 out of 20 remains here to, this is the perspective for other teachers. When there's somebody who's persistently complaining, I think it's very cool to say, sure, you can stay and keep complaining. Just keep staying and keep complaining. That's good for you. That's where you should be. You should be here, and you remain here, and you keep complaining. If that's what you like, go right ahead. I hope you're well. But that's only 1 out of 20, so that's okay, I guess. It seems to me there's the educated and the uneducated, but the uneducated, or, you know, non-degreed, while their mind may be less complex, they're commonly, I mean, everybody seems to watch television. And so everyone pretty much is brainwashed by the political, the media, and the medical, and the corporate, and. But the educated, particularly BAMA folks, you know, graduate school, early graduate school like MA and bachelor, are the most brainwashed. Although I guess you can say that the uneducated who watch a lot of TV are pretty brainwashed too. Yes, yes. But it's the educated brainwashed that have the most pride. And so the subtitle, I mean, that I've been looking at, working from, thinking of, is Discovery Beyond Pride and Ignorance. How is it that we learn? Well, this is, again, how is it that the conscious mind recognizes that there's a lot I don't know in the subconscious, or of truth, or of reality that is true, that I don't really know about myself, about my patterns, about the world, about you, about us, about anything, any matter. We learn, it seems, by first a humble, honest acknowledgement that we don't know. Actually, it's not that hard to acknowledge that there's a lot we don't know. Whenever we have a question or wonder about something, obviously it's a sign we don't know. It's just critical to consider that there's a lot more going on here than I've been considering. And this is now a chakra matter of 2 through 5, where it's pride and ignorance, or it's pride that maintains ignorance that prevents learning. Pride, or egoism, egotism, ego. It's not the ego. It's patterns of pride and vanity and conceit, particularly pride and conceit. I went to this college. I have this position. I am a very important person. And a lot of people, you know, need to listen to me because I'm important, because I have this position and I make a lot of money and I have a big car and other people look up to me. So then you're very important. Pride, you know, pride goes before the fall. It seems to me this humanity really deserves the fall they're taking. They're taking a big old fall. As a certain example of numbers, it was Songkran, which is a Thai, pretty much New Year holiday. It's like maybe the most important. Somebody said, like Christmas and Easter or New Year, Christmas and Thanksgiving rolled up together, and so they're here in Chiang Mai, in the city, where 3 days of revelry. Which basically made an unbelievable mass of people in the streets, in their cars, in the motorcycle, in the motorbike, completely impassable gridlock for, you know, a couple square miles. Several square miles of gridlock in the city. With people throwing water on each other willy-nilly, squirt guns, dancing to the booming soundstage on this block, and another block over is the next booming soundstage. Like that. They've had a lot of fun. There was a lot of letting off of steam. It was a very hot day. It's nice to have water. That was fun for the peoples. They're not obviously... I don't know how brainwashed they are, whatever, but... in some sense, it seems to me humanity hasn't learned much for the entirety of this 3D cycle. Just like Yeshua said about the wheat and the tares, or as far as I can understand it, there's this tangled, entwined condition of positively oriented souls, negatively oriented souls, tendencies to love and wisdom and healing and balance and virtue and goodness, intertwined with tendencies to selfishness and ignorance and arrogance and harmfulness and deception and ... harming to self and other. All this good and bad, or kusala akusala dhamma, are intertwined with this race of 3D repeaters, it seems to me. And if even so close, I mean, you know, revelry, I'm sure there's no harm to revelry. Is there harm to revelry? I guess it depends on what's happening. Is it good? Is it bad? Well, you can say I'm bad to suggest it might be bad, but bad, you know, let people do what they want. It's not particularly bad, it just ain't going nowhere. And fine, do what you want, you know, not my problem, not my thing. You had a great fun time. Great. It just seems that this race is kind of hopeless, frankly. And like we were saying in class before, those at a lower level of the power, money pyramid, in general, don't dislike the system. They just dislike their position within it. And when they see their authorities, they sort of say, that's a big me, like mini me and big me. I really feel that many people, probably both the educated and the uneducated, those that, you know, went beyond high school, those that finished high school, I guess are called, what, the moderately educated? And I don't mean that education is some mark of sanctity, not at all. But there, if you want to understand the people around you, you might want to understand that some have been heavily educated in schools and have some have not. And some, and most, however, have been heavily influenced by television. And the result is that most everybody, seriously, they really do trust doctors and media. Why do they watch TV? Because they don't hate it. Why don't they hate TV? Well, maybe I'm just an angry misanthrope. Oh, he's an angry misanthrope, said the carping critical. Maybe, but that's God too. You know that too, right? So, all right. There's the educated, there's the uneducated, but they're pretty much all brainwashed or watching television. Why? Because they like it, or they trust it. I guess they trust it. They surely don't detest it. Okay. Should they? I don't know. I don't think anybody should stay stuck in aversion. Me too. Yes, I'm discovering a lot more deeper levels of aversion. I'm a natural born misanthrope, as they say. So I've been a misanthrope for a long time, probably before I came here. But when I meet individuals, they're all decent to me, and they're kindly, and sometimes I feel pity and compassion and love and kindness and softness and, you know, tender feeling for people, because I can see their pain and feel it. But they watch television because they trust what they're being told, and they do not detest it, and they are ripe, you know, for brainwashing and manipulation. They have no idea. The brainwashing basically says, you are chosen, you are one of the good people for complying with me. There's reward for compliance, and there's stigmatization or villainization of those that don't comply, right? I told somebody asked me, you don't have a cell phone. And I said, yeah, I don't have a cell phone. I never had a cell phone. And she told me, well, you know, I'm wondering about you. you must be, she didn't say it directly, but she's sort of implying, you must be a criminal if you don't have a cell phone, right? Everybody has a cell phone, right? You must be something wrong with you. Either you're running away from something, or you're a criminal, or you're a weirdo. Oh, okay. That's how many people think, actually. Or some. The relevance there is simply that they think they know, but they don't. And we too, in many ways, know this and that, but need to remember that knowing never ends, meaning learning. And there's always more that we haven't seen. Even if you know the root structure, the subterranean portions of the tree are not visible. They can be, they're tangible, they're knowable, but they do remain invisible. This is a little bit like transit from spirit complex healing initiation, or from mind complex healing and initiation to spirit, where I was talking about, I'm not sure if the light in the darkness, which was it, I'm not sure if it's the significator of spirit card in the tarot, or potentiator maybe, blasted tower. Light in the darkness is the way of gnosis and realization of some truth, not only spiritual realities, but any kind of deeper epiphany or gnosis comes as a flash in the dark. All of this is basically to say, don't presume you understand anything fully. Don't presume a final understanding. There's so much more going on than we see. The invisible is, and is vast. This is a very important thing. And so when we see a situation, we really ought to consider the idea that there's much more going on here than I see. And if I want to see it, I probably need to be quiet and take a break and come back and stop thinking. Thinking and thinking remains at the level of thinking. And the level of thinking is actually visible, shallow, not necessarily so deep, unless it's coming from, it's associated with the thinking of a deep insight, the thinking of a revelation, the thinking of a deeper knowing matter, a matter of deeper knowing, an issue for deeper knowing. Thinking upon that is deep thinking. But commonly, thinking is circular. And we're just thinking the same as we've been thinking. This is pretty shallow, and this staying at that level is problematic. Staying at that level of thinking to find answers or see options or see conditions or learn and know is problematic because one doesn't go subterranean or one doesn't enter the unseen. One has to enter the darkness to illumine the darkness. You can't bring illumination if you remain in the seen. Illumination is of, per se, intrinsically, of the unseen. And the unseen is the subconscious or below, you know, below the visible portions of the tree of mind. And that begins with an eagerness, I'd say, an eagerness to acknowledge how little I know. I'm eager to know I don't know, or I know only little, when it's important. You know, it's not like I want to know everything about everything, but when it's important, I think it's useful to eagerly seek to know what we don't know and see what we haven't yet seen. And that's how new learning comes. This is this idea of discovery beyond pride and ignorance. And the chakra pull in here is that second chakra blockage associated with distortions in the sense of self. Deflation, inflation, I'm the best, I'm the worst, I hate myself, or I'm superior to all, right? Self-loathing and self-deification, self-glorification, which is so silly. I mean, the self-glorifiers are such fools. It's so, everyone with wisdom, and you know, those who see don't say. Commonly, those who see don't say. Those who see what others don't want to see and don't see, and you know, people don't see because they don't want to see. We don't know because we don't want to know, commonly. I mean, or there's a lot that we don't know because we don't really want to know enough. We don't strongly wish to know. We don't wish to know strongly enough. The motivation to see and know is simply too weak to come to the seeing and knowing, generally because it affects our pride. That's a very common matter. So second chakra blockage, the bipolar distortions in the sense of self, inflation, deflation, grandiosity, self-loathing, self-pity versus self-centeredness in a crude, common, silly way. This impairs learning and knowing. This keeps mind shallow. The more pride, the more stupid that mind. And many people are stupid and don't know it. And you can say, I'm stupid and don't know it. Maybe, obviously, because there's a shitload I don't know. But I know I don't know. And that's a big difference. And I'm not, this is not like saying I'm better, but you know, the teacher, anyone who's trying to teach or help, you know, intrinsically has, there's a presumption in play that this teacher, he or she knows something. And that maybe you guys or anyone listening doesn't know it as well. Is that arrogance per se? I don't think it has to be. But there's some presumption that the speaker knows what they're saying. And there's some presumption that if I believe that this is relevant, then I believe it's relevant because some people who will be listening don't know it or don't know it enough or ought to hear it again, or it's valuable to review this this whole matter. But yeah, I think that very few people want to know how little they know and want to realize the fact of the unseen. And it all comes down to second chakra blockage. It all comes down to a weak sense of self, or a sense of self as weak. I can't take it.
You can't take truth. You can't handle it.
Yeah, lots of people can't handle. And so, ignorance based in pride, pride based in wounding, wounding based in, you know, childhood, family, systems, dynamics, psychodynamics of the family system, wounding on lack of love from parents, abuse, violation, harm, neglect, as well as past life carry-in. So the wounding unseen remains and compounds. Commonly, the person meets it with a compensatory pride or self-assertion, and the arrogant may be the most wounded, and the naturally humble, simple is less wounded, yeah. And commonly, the educational systems are wounding. The more educated, the more wounded. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's intellectual wounding, too. And indoctrination is a coercive process. And so the company man, the team player, is a servant to the ideology of the collective, of that group. Clearly, it's violational. And so the wounded don't want to acknowledge the extent of their wounding, or we commonly too, or where we are wounded and don't know and don't see and don't heal. It's because we don't want to see it, for sure. And so, you know, the leadership represents an amplification of the service of self tendencies of the masses. The distortions of the human, of this human collective, is sort of an amplification or a picture writ large of our own personal distortions and tendencies. Absolutely. You know? So I'll cop to it too. So it's then actually impossible to, or it's all discussion will be limited. Therefore, I was taking some Uber or Gab or Grab or whatever that is, some kind of cell phone, car service, telephone pickup system, and talking with the driver. Actually, no, it was somebody else. But anyway, she ends up telling me that she's with her partner, they're lesbian, and although she's maybe bisexual or something, blah, 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 whatever. And having various troubles, so I ended up doing counseling with her from the back seat. And it was just clear, it's just yet another example where she can't quite talk things through with her partner. The partner doesn't really want to, and she herself is stymied by confusion about what's really happening in the partnership. Is it my fault? Is it her fault? Who's wrong here, and why am I feeling bad? We've broken up many times, but we're back together again, but she has this other partner, and she falls back to the other partner whenever we have a problem, and I don't really like it. And but she, you know, so I'm trying to identify to her that both you and your partner could do better here, and yet deep communication between the two of you is essential. And I can see how she can't do deep communication with her partner because she can't do deep knowing with herself. So, you know, healing is first practice on the self, healing of other self, first practice on the self. Likewise, communication with other is first practiced or learned by practice of self-communication between conscious and subconscious. Right? The primary relationship, man and God, begins at home with conscious and subconscious. And, you know, with the magician and the high priestess, that's the primary couple. Our sense of self, the visible, the conscious mind, sense of self, personality, what we're aware of and can speak, the thinking to speaking, the feeling to thinking, to knowing, to speaking, that's all of the conscious mind, and that's commonly the extent of the domain of identity. Identity is commonly equated to the conscious mind, which is the great pity, the great sorrow of Earth humanity. They know themselves as thinking peoples only, as thinking persons in bodies, not with the subconscious. What more of the whole being there isn't known. because of there's a lot of pain, because to know to know freedom, you first have to go through all the fetters and bindings that keep one from freedom. One must, to be in freedom, one must first leave the jail. You can't leave the jail or the prison or the cell. The prison cell cannot be vacated for freedom until you acknowledge, I'm in a prison cell, or I'm feeling shitty. And that's, back to first noble truth, dukkha, the truth of dukkha, as Gautama said. And I have, endless appreciation for Gautama, simply just the point that he simply put dukkha front and center. Dukkha is the condition of subjective beingness in the octave, beginning in three, or late two, second density, ending with harvest to seven. So the big middle is 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Chakras 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Densities 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The early is 2 and the late is 6. The heart is 3, 4, 5. 3, 4, 5 is the real meat in the sandwich. That's the sandwich of fraudulent identity and endless dukkha. Endless dukkha doesn't mean I'm in agony 24/7. It means all phenomenal experience of a so-called self is impermanent. It's empty of abiding self-nature. Anatta doesn't only mean no self, it means no self-nature. Self-nature means, it doesn't mean no true nature. It means no separated, unchanging beingness that is some kind of eternal selfhood. In many ways, it really was, I think, a teaching to neutralize distortions of the Vedic tradition, the Brahmanic tradition, 2,500 years ago in India, where Gautama is really saying, you have reified Atman. Don't tell me that Nityananda and Nisargadatta and Ramana Maharshi have reified Atman, fellows in Singapore and Hong Kong. So don't tell me that they've reified Atman. I don't think so. I wouldn't presume they have. I would presume they haven't. But I imagine that all sorts of mistakes of distorted understanding of core Vedic teachings at the time of Gautama that we see in Sutta Nipata, talking to all these young Brahmin fellows, was part of the basis of the teaching, the basis for the teaching of anatta, no self. No self nature means that there is no stable, eternal, separative selfhood that is. And that itself is a reification, that the notion that there is common, right? It's what happens when you only see the visible portion of the tree of mind. When you identify with the conscious mind, you become a charvaka, and may well then later, taking that, reify Atman. Atman is not a being, it's a beingness. Atman is not a being, it's a beingness. That's why identity can be dropped, because it's fraud. There is no reality to the sense of identity, even at the level of Atman or six density. Leaving six, it's known that identity was always Maya and Sunya. And I think Gautama was teaching to help Brahmins and Hindus who had fallen into reification of Atman, helping them get beyond, sixth density. But in general, okay, that's a flight. So in general, the more the mind, the more the heart chakra is activated in play, the more there's going to be communication between so-called lower and so-called higher. 2, 3, 2, 5, 6. 2, 3, communicating with 5, 6. Right? The other, the the alpha and the omega of soul evolution with identity. The alpha begins in two, and end, and the omega, or if alpha omega means beginning and end, maybe not, but the start is the proto self animal, dog, cat with a spunky sense of personality, or you know, great ape or whale, maybe dolphin, maybe elephant, horse, yeah. And the end of it is leaving, you know, sixth density. But there's really no talking with a lot of people to the level of what they need. For many people can't access what they need because their sense of self is too wounded. And that's too blocking five. The deep knowing won't happen for those who are too wounded and in pain, for those who don't have a somewhat trained mental faculty, and then the pride and the arrogant and the conceited who think that they already know, and what more is there? So it's simply to say that when we fall into a condition and say, I thought I finished with this years ago, why is it still coming up? Well, you were wrong to think that you finished it years ago. Just because it doesn't appear doesn't mean it is not. It means it is not appearing. Not appearing does not mean non-existence or doesn't exist. It simply means not appearing. Is it not? It may not be, but it may well remain mainly unseen or exclusively unseen. Just knowing that that's the way life is, that there's so much I don't know, and always more can be known, and that knowing is a happy matter. After you've passed through the pain of what you didn't want to see, there's the joy of what you're really happy to see, actually. There's a whole lot that can be seen that's beautiful. There's a lot of beauty. I mean, the hallowed, consecrate nature of everyday things, as Ra said, as related to contact with intelligent infinity or seven chakra activation. It's really 6-7 chakra linkage. A sense of, you know, God is here, the sacred is here. But I can say that, and you can say, yeah, but do you live it? Do I live it? Well, sometimes, not 24/7. It would be nice to live it more. But just because we think it doesn't mean we know it deeply, and surely doesn't mean we can live it. Meanwhile, that's good if we discover, well, I can thinking it, I know that's true, all is one, it's all God, it's all love, light, but I don't really live it. And I'd like to more. How? Well, in many ways, one has to train the mind. Train the mind to be free of grasping and aversion. And that's done by Anapanasati or other mindfulness technique meditation practices, for sure, without a doubt. So, I see the time is running. It's 42:33, or actually 43:33 was there. So, 333, hey, hey, that'll be it for today. 333, hey, 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 that's it for today. I hope you have a good day, too. And so, I'm not sure when we'll be back, or when I'll be back, you know, when our group will continue, we'll talk. So I don't know when the next talk is, and hopefully I can upload this to YouTube. But please take good care of yourselves. Deep seeking, deep knowing passes through the painful to increasing glory and deep well-being. And I'm not saying I'm in deep well-being either, but I know it can be because I've been there. So, you know, seek the one, and the one will be seeking you. And I hope this was helpful. Please take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.